So what had happened was, in the years preceding 1826, the weavers had faced a number of economic crises. For example, in 1825, the Bank of England collapsed and there was a financial crisis which cut across the country. And indeed, the Bank of England had to be kind of bailed out by the Bank of France. It was that serious. And given the hostility between France and England only a few years earlier with the Napoleonic Wars, that gives you an indication of the level of desperation and financial kind of crisis that was there. You then saw a really deep economic depression that hit in particular the cotton trade. And given that the cotton trade and the weaving trade was so significant in East Lancashire, and indeed in Lancashire and Cheshire more broadly, this was always going to have a big impact on the local population. But the weavers in East Lancashire made up somewhere in the region of 2/5 of the population. And that was an enormous amount of kind of economic labour that was suddenly being kind of torn apart by the kind of economic depression. It also been a factor that their wages had been going down. And they'd been petitioning the government and kind of Lord Liverpool. They'd been asking for a kind of a stabilised minimum wage. And that hadn't happened. And of course, what becomes interesting at that point is when we start talking about banking crises, minimum wages and food poverty. I'm talking about 1826, but of course I could be talking about, you know, today, because those kind of things have happened to us all here in England in the last decade or so. But because the crises had been a kind of a multiple nature, by the time it got to 1826, the weavers had effectively sold everything in the houses. So they had nothing left. There was nothing to kind of sell to get a little bit of money for food. They basically were living in rags. They no longer had kind of decent clothes because they'd all been sold. Some of them had probably sold their shoes. They had nothing. There was, in their houses, there was basically straw and hay and the handloom. And there could be families kind of living off that. And they were working for maybe kind of 12 to 14 hours a day for next to nothing. And a lot of their kind of, even in the good times, in the years before that, they've been dependent on parish relief to basically kind of top up the wages. So when it came to the depression and when there was no work, or very little work, and somewhere in the region of maybe 50 to 75% of the handlovers were actually without work. And if they went for more than 3 weeks without work, they were literally facing starvation. And this, we're talking about an economic kind of situation that lasted from 1825 right the way through to August 1827. And so we have this scenario of people with nothing, no work, no kind of financial support, and they were literally desperate. So they came up with a plan, which was just, how do we send a message to the government? Because the government's approach was laissez-faire. It was basically, we're not going to give you any form of genuine kind of subsistence and welfare relief, because if we do that, then what's going to happen is the employers are going to take that as a signal to give you even lower wages. So they were kind of arguing, we're not helping you for your own good, which of course was a very weak argument given the mass levels of starvation and kind of food poverty that was the people were facing. So there was that kind of really key element that was important. And then at the same time, we were also seeing the introduction of the power looms into the kind of shift from the kind of the handloom weaving and the kind of the cottage industry, because they were literally in their cottages, sometimes with a bit of small hauling land, but they were in their cottages with the handloom, and then they were moving towards the kind of factories and the mills, and the kind of the industrialization of the weaving process. Now this was a really big threat in particular for the handloom weavers who were men, because the people who were going to work in the factories were women and children. They were giving lower wages. They were also seen as more docile and more easy to control by the mill owners. So you had this kind of juxtaposition of a real problem of starvation. And this became increasingly evident when we start to think about the number of people who died of starvation in East Lancashire in the period following the uprising, which evidences that this was genuinely a desperate call for an input into actually giving them kind of enough money to feed themselves. And then you have this new movement towards the power loom, this new technology, which in effect was kind of became a kind of representative of the dangers to the way of life of the handloom weavers at that time. So the assault on the handloom, on the power looms was basically kind of an attempt to send a message to government that they were starving to death, and that in effect this was to kind of say, look, please help us. Please try and avert a massive human catastrophe, which will be the loss of life on a scale which is kind of which is enormous, even for that period of time. And that was what they were trying to do. That was the reason, that was the motivation. And that's why we call it an uprising, because it's only when you call it an uprising that you start to understand that there were political and genuine humanitarian reasons for this. This wasn't Luddism. This wasn't a situation where people were scared of technology. The power looms were chosen because they ultimately were a means of kind of indicating that this was a very focused form of destruction which would send a message to their masters and to the government as a cry for help.
So what happened at the Chatterton massacre then, David?
Well, the Chatterton massacre was on the 26th of April 1826, and in effect six local people were killed by British soldiers. So the context of the massacre was that this was the third day of the uprising. So there'd been an uprising over towards Accrington and over towards Blackburn. There'd also been on the second day an uprising heading down towards Helmshaw and Haslingden. And on the third day, a crowd of somewhere in the region of between 3,000 to 4,000 people made their way across from Rawtenstall and Haslingden over to Edenfield and then down to Chatterton. But when they got to Chatterton, the local magistrate and the soldiers were waiting for them. So on Old Chatterton Lane, the magistrate, William Grant, read the Riot Act. Now, the Riot Act was significant for two reasons. First of all, it meant that at that time, soldiers could kill people and there would be no possible criminal prosecutions. Secondly, the Riot Act was significant for the mill owners because it meant that through the assize courts, they could actually claim back full compensation for any damage done by the crowd. So the Riot Act was read, and the crowd of around about 3,000 people made their way down to Aitken and Lord's Mill at the site of Chatterton. Now, the soldiers, there were two different groups of soldiers. There was the Queen Bays, there was 15 Queen Bays, and they were basically the cavalry. So they're in their big red kind of uniforms and the black hats and the sabres, and they were on their horsebacks, and they made their way behind the kind of Chatterton cottages and awaited further instructions there. There were 20 riflemen, and these riflemen were from the 60th Duke of York own rifles, and they were sharpshooters. They were actually they were snipers in effect, and they were highly trained soldiers, and they basically lined up at the bottom of Chatterton Old Lane and the intersection with Chatterton Lane, and they started firing. The soldiers fired somewhere in the region of 600 bullets into a crowd of 3,000. We know that at least four people were seriously wounded by this, and there may have been many others. But there were also six people who were killed. The first person who was killed was James Lord. And James Lord had basically thrown a stone at Colonel Kearney. And the soldiers immediately turned and shot him in the back of the head. And they basically blew his brains out. So James Lord was shot dead basically for throwing a stone at an army soldier. You then had the death of John Ashworth. And John Ashworth was again was shot, and he died pretty much on the spot. Third person who was killed was James Rothwell, and he again was kind of shot and pretty much died instantly. As the kind of the crowd continued to break into and to attempt and ultimately successfully destroy a large number of power looms within Aitkind and Lord's factory, a further man was killed. This was Richard Lund, and Richard Lund was actually making his way out of the back of the factory through a window, and he was shot, and he crawled in agony across the River Irwell and died on the other side of the Irwell towards Strong Street. The crowd then started to disperse. The power looms had been destroyed within the Aitkind and Lord's mill. Aitkind, the mill owner, had fled with his family. The soldiers dispersed around Chatterton Lane to first of all push some of the protesters, around about 200 of them, down towards Bury. And the remaining 2,000 or so made their way back, some of them carrying wounded, some of them kind of wounded themselves. And some of them made their way over towards their home back in Haslingden. Some made their way over the moors towards Bacup. But this wasn't the end of the killing. And this is why it becomes very obvious that this is a massacre, because there was a range of indiscriminate killing. So behind the Chatterton cottages, which faced the mill, there was a number of people who were there. And one of them was a woman called Mary Simpson, who was a 23-year-old woman who had made her way from Rawtenstall to Edenfield to get the coach to Manchester. But because of all the people who were there, she was late, and the coach had gone, because there was a crowd of 3,000 in a very, very small area. It meant there was big delays. So she decided to go down and see what was going on. She was shot in the thigh and bled to death on the kind of, having done nothing to be related with the actual the uprising itself. However, the soldiers at the time claimed that she was a rioter, and there was negative reputation spread to kind of justify why she'd been killed. But there was enough people knew that she literally was just on her way to Manchester. That reputation was then kind of restored, and it became clear that she actually was just accidentally killed by soldiers with possibly a stray shot. But there was one further death, and this was a man called James Whittaker. And before the protesters had actually come down to Chatterton and the riot act had been read, they'd actually been up at Dearden Clough Mill, and James Whittaker had been one of the people who'd actually tried to fortify the mill in the interest of the mill owner, and actually had helped take off some of the wraps of the power looms to kind of save them from being destroyed in the uprising itself. He was then walking down with his friend Richard Leach, and was hiding near to where the Chatterton cottages were. He then, for some reason, thought it would be safest to try and get into number 12 Chatterton, and he was banging on the door of Mrs. Upton's house when he was shot dead at close range by one of the British soldiers. He bled to death on the doorstep and died from his wounds a few minutes later. The soldiers ignored him, went into the house, grabbed a protester who was hiding under Mrs. Upton's bed, came back out and went and left James Whittaker to die. So you had these six deaths that were a kind of clearly associated with the soldiers who, at least at some point, seemed to lose it. This wasn't a situation where there was just disciplined order. With 600 bullets being fired, a number of the soldiers must have deliberately aimed to miss. Because even if there were a significant number of injuries, which we believe there were, with 600 bullets at close range, that if they'd actually aimed for people, there would have been much more death and there would have been much more serious injury. So many of the soldiers probably fired over the crowd. But when it came to the second part, when it came to dispersal of the actual crowd, then the soldiers seemed to kind of go into their own zone and they became killing machines, as was evidenced with the death of James Whittaker. That wasn't the end of the story, because another man died on the 26th of September, Thomas Ashworth. He died after being given the death penalty, because the response of the state to Chatterton wasn't to recognise the starvation issue, but was rather to actually punish the people who had been involved. And 41 death sentences were given for people in the uprising as a whole. 31 of those were commuted to imprisonment, and a further 10 people, including the local woman Mary Hindle, who'd been arrested after day two of the uprising at Helmshaw Textile Museum, as it is today, or Turner's Mill, as it was back in 1826. She was looking for a six-year-old daughter and basically was giving some encouragement, as many people were, because the whole communities were in desperate kind of need and they were kind of supportive of at least somebody doing something to send a message about the starvation and poverty. She was ultimately sent over to New South Wales and she took her own life there. So the death toll continued for quite some time. And you have this kind of broader sense that what happened at Chatterton became really something that the government and the army tried to close down as quickly as possible. So the inquests were actually held on the 27th of April 1826 in Edenfield, but no public were allowed to enter. Now, this was incredibly significant, because when you have the local Lancastrian people, the local weavers in particular, these were poorly educated people. They didn't have a lot of reading and writing skills. They didn't leave long narratives and testimonies of their lives or biographies. They didn't have that kind of focus in their lives. They were simply going from day to day, trying to survive and eke out an existence in very, very difficult situations. So one of the places historically where their voice was heard was in the coroner's court. So it was profoundly significant that they were not allowed to attend, that the court was actually closed down. And indeed, the coroner was one of the more infamous coroners from Peterloo. And he came to the various different verdicts. The four people who were shot by the soldiers at the start, they were given an inquest verdict of shot by the mob, shot in the mob, or shot as part of a mob. You then had the death of Mary Simpson, where she was regarded as being an accidental death. But the death of James Whittaker was actually defined as murder by an unknown soldier. Now, people knew who the soldier was, but of course they were never allowed to give that testimony and evidence in the coroner's court. What you then found was that the soldiers, within a week of the inquests happening, were carted off to Portugal. They were taken out of the scene. And perhaps the most illuminating situation was that following the Chatterton massacre, there were prosecutions at every other site of the uprising, but none from Chatterton. Now, the justification given for shooting these six people and for the opening of a cavalry charge and the opening of the to disperse the people and the opening of the riflemen to the 600 bullets in 15 minute spell, this was all supposed to be because the mob or the crowd had lost it. Why were there no criminal prosecutions? If they were responsible and culpable for ultimately for leading towards the soldiers to fear for their lives, Why were there no significant injuries to the soldiers? Why was the people who died and the people who were injured all from the crowd? Why was there no criminal prosecution? Well, the reason why there was no criminal prosecution was simply because a criminal court case was another avenue for testimonies to be given, was another avenue for the local people to give their side of the story, for them to describe the massacre, for this to be given as something which actually for what it was, which was the indiscriminate killing of six people by the state. So on the first day, we started at Winnie Hill, which is on the outskirts of Accrington. And we followed the route of the Weavers down into Accrington and up to Fern Gore. And then the Weavers actually then went down to White Ash Mill to destroy some power looms, and then across towards Ozzeltwizzle, and then ended up in Jubilee Street. We actually ended a fraction short of that at Stanhill. But that was still about 10 miles on that day. And then the second day started just on the outskirts of Darwin, and went down from Darwin to Hoddlesden, which is a small village where the mill owner John Garston had lived, and the Weavers had gone there to beg for food and basically wouldn't give them any, so they destroyed some power looms on his property. They then made their way up via Pickup Bank and right the way across the moors. And I always kind of get the feeling when you've got maybe something like, I don't know, at that point there'd have been quite a few hundred people on that day, going across the moorland, as you can see just behind us, with, you know, it's quite difficult terrain.
Yeah.
If you haven't got shoes on, if you've got clogs on, I think most of the days of the uprising it was reasonably dry, but if it had been raining on some of them...
But it's quite cold today and we're wrapped up, aren't
yeah,
we?
Yeah, we're kind of got the big jackets on, and you're thinking like, you know,
cold.
this is kind of, it's dry, and it's and they would have had probably very few clothes, and going across the top moor over and down by Mulsbury Valley and then into Helmshaw, which was then Turner's Mill and is today Helmshaw Textile Museum. So we covered that on day two. And then day three was basically the day of the Chatterton Massacre. And we started there at Rottenstall and went across to Edenfield and then down into Chatterton itself and laid the wreath for all those who died, not just those at Chatterton, but also for the people who had died in Bradford, because a week after Chatterton, two other people were shot dead by soldiers. And John Herney, who was a 13-year-old boy, and Jonas Bairstow, who was 18, they were shot after breaking into Horsfall's Mill by the Yorkshire Hussars. So we noted that. We also noted the death of Andrew Ashworth, who was basically... somebody who died after being given the death penalty. So we kind of, and the other people who died in East Lancashire more broadly. So yesterday we kind of paid a tribute and paid memorial commemorations to the broader scope of tragedy and the broader kind of elements of death in East Lancashire at that time. Some of which we call a massacre, some of which we call social murder. And then the actual the crowd split in two,
yeah,
following the massacre. Yesterday, I followed the route that went down into Somerset, where the kind of attacked power looms in Higher Somerset Mill, and then down all the way following the River Irwell to Elton. And actually, they were disrupted there by soldiers, and they were kind of they made an escape without destroying all the power looms.
Mm-hmm.
But the vast majority of the 3,000 people who were down at Chatterton on the day of the massacre, they made their way back up over the moors and over towards Bacup. And that will be the journey tomorrow. So we'll be continuing day three on day five, because there's only actually 4 days of the uprising. But today is day four, and we started in Tockholes
As you know, Janet, because you were there. So we started in Tockholes and we made our way down to, first of all, Abbey Village, and then followed the nature trail down, which was the start of the railway line as it was, to Brinskill, and then all the way from Brinskill to here, where we are now in White Coppice. And then the walk will continue down towards the top end of Angles Arc Reservoir, up via Healy Knapp, which is a nice wooded area, and then down to Botany Bay, which is on the outskirts of Chorley. So another couple of miles yet to go. There's a couple of reasons why I find this story so fascinating. One of which I think is because it has resonance with the present. I think that it gives us an example of what happens when the state is completely morally indifferent and shows complete neglect towards the needs of ordinary people in terms of issues around food poverty. I think that you can't get away from the fact that, you know, there are connections between the difficulties that the weavers and other people in East Lancashire were facing back in 1826 and some of the nature of poverty and social exclusion which exists here today, and the fact that there was just no sense of loyalty or commitment or respect for those people. Yeah. And the solution for the government was largely two things back in 1826. It was largely to kind of punish those people who rebelled, and if that didn't work, to talk about emigration, mass emigration. You had people who were literally eating porridge three times a day. Yeah. They had their basic diet was oatmeal plus water. So you had this scenario where there really wasn't a situation where these people had any money to kind of buy decent clothes, have a decent kind of standard of living, and that standard of living crisis that we're currently facing again caused kind of resonance.
We know there isn't a famine now, but there will be people going hungry, and when we look back at things like this, you think that's such a long time ago, it would never happen now, but it clearly is, isn't it? And it's no point feeling sorry for people in the past when you can't have any empathy for people who are with us right now.
Yeah.
So how did you discover all of this? What happened? How did you fall on this piece of history?
Well, it was by complete coincidence, and what happened was basically I got a rescue dog a couple of years ago, and it just was so much easier to take her down to quite isolated parks where she could kind of be free and run around. And we discovered Chatterton Peace Park, and the dog loved it there, so I started to look into why it was called Peace Park, which as it turned out was something to do with the ending of the First World War. But at the same time, I then discovered that there had been a kind of number of people who had been killed there. There was a blue plaque. So I started to look into it further, and I started to ask people about kind of what had happened there and how it was defined and understood. Some of the local people just said that nobody had been killed then, it was a mistake, and that actually people had been killed elsewhere in Rossendale, and they hadn't been killed in Chatterton. I then started looking a bit further and I found the inquest records, which pretty much indicated that six people had definitely been killed, and the kind of the broader story that we've been talking about. And then I started to kind of do a bit of kind of wider reading. I found William Turner's book, which was called Riot, which was published in 1992, which gives a very vivid account of what happened. I found a few journal articles. I started to look into the reasons behind the depression of 1826 and the banking collapse of 1825. Yeah. I started to look at the handloom weavers' experience and what it was like to kind of live in East Lancashire at that time. So I started to then uncover. And the question that always kind of motivated me was, why is this not identified in the history books? Why is something which is almost equivalent to Peterloo, which happened in 1819, why is Peterloo well known and why is Chatterton almost kind of forgotten? Why is this lost? And one of the things that kind of really driven me on is the fact that this isn't appropriately recognised as such. This isn't defined as a massacre in the list of British massacres. It's a hidden massacre. And I think that what's driving me on is that sense of injustice, that invisibility, and the fact that we are not paying the appropriate remembrance and homage to those people who died 196 years ago. A local relief committee was set up in Manchester, which also basically did try and kind of provide some funding for the people in the kind of area. But by May, so within a few weeks of the Chatterton massacre and the uprising itself, there was a London relief committee set up, which included people like the Archbishop of Canterbury. It included representatives of the King. It included the Home Secretary, Sir Robert Peel. And they generated an awful lot of money because they recognised at that point that what was happening in East Lancashire was a genuine form of mass starvation. And this was probably one of the worst hit areas in the country, and indeed historically, this has been one of the kind of biggest kind of tragedies in terms of the weavers and in terms of what happened to them and in terms of loss of life. That, and yet at the same time, there was nobody taking responsibility for it. Robert Peel, who was the Sir Robert Peel, who was the Home Secretary at that time, said that nobody who was involved in the uprising should receive any of the London Relief Committee's money. So they still had that punitive mentality. You know, those who had actually protested and those had said, we are starving, shoot us rather than let us starve, the approach was still one of, you are undeserving of our help and support. You should never have protested. And so there were, it was very difficult for those who'd been engaged. And you're thinking about big mass popular protests of 3,000 to 4,000 people across different parts. So there would have been literally thousands of people across the region of East Lancashire who were engaging in this as either active participants in the protests and the power loom destruction, or they were involved in terms of supporting it and being bystanders. So you had this, and then John Fielden, who was the MP for Blackburn at the time, when he gave evidence to the Emigration Committee of 1827, which seriously was the idea that you would emigrate large parts of East Lancashire population to Australia, which sounds unbelievable. That was the kind of one of the solutions to the problem. He noted that when it came to the actual relief committee money, large parts of this money was probably being siphoned off to pay for compensation for the power loom destruction. So when the Lancashire Assize came together and heard the criminal convictions for the people involved in the uprisings, when there was the 41 death penalties, death sentence were given out, when you had the 10 people who were transported to Australia, there was also at the same time the claims for compensation made by the mill owners. And what they did was they basically got the people in the different hundreds, which are the kind of the boundaries of the different regions at that time. So the Blackburn Hundred was the one which was more significant because that covered most of the area where the uprising in East Lancashire had taken place. But there was also the Leyland 100 over this side, and also the Salford 100, which went from kind of Ramsbottom down into Manchester itself and through Bury. What the kind of courts directed was that these people in these areas, the very same people who were starving to death, had to pay the compensation to the mill owners for the destruction of the power looms. So not only did they have no money, they also were now responsible for paying the costs for the damage. Now a power loom would have estimated to have cost around about £10 to replace, but some of the mill owners put in claims for £15, which is a 50% increase, and they got the money. So it wasn't all of them. Some were honest and actually did say, you know, I had 100 power looms, they were £10 each, so that's £1,000 I need to get back from the local community. Now, of course, they had no money, but there was lots of money coming in from the kind of for food.
Yeah.
So John Fielden, the Blackburn MP, effectively indicated to the Immigration Committee that the money that was supposed to be going to those who were starving went to the mill owners in compensation. The village and town of Haslingden, which had a population of approximately 6,000 people in 1826, We know that between April 1826 and March 1827, 137 children under the age of four died.
Wow.
Now, they will have been of starvation and other illnesses which have been kind of generated.
Malnutrition,
yeah. Cholera, kind of other kind of things which basically would be related to those who've been kind of immune systems being weakened by starvation. And it's always the children who are most likely to be impacted.
That's terrible.
So we know from that one place alone, and say we're looking at 37 different records, this is one record which gives us best indication of over 137 child deaths. And there was more than that because there were some adults died in that period of time as well.
Yeah.
So when we start to think about it, you know, we're looking at a massacre, which is sometimes defined as a riot, which of course places the blame onto that to individuals, sometimes defined as a fight, which again erases the sense that actually people were killed here. We need to call it the massacre because we need to kind of recognise that there was indiscriminate killing at Chatterton. We need to think about this, I would say, as social murder.
Yeah.
It's not just kind of something where we have a kind of people dying and it's an accident. This was people dying and a government refusing to provide them with appropriate subsistence, with mill owners and local property gentlemen taking money or taking kind of goods which would have been kind of going to the poor and actually allowing them to kind of starve to death. And that, I think, is the kind of, in a nutshell, brings this tragedy into, I think, a combination of both a massacre and social murder in East Lancashire. And for me, the invisibility of this is what kind of motivates me on, and that's why I've established the Weavers Uprising Bicentennial Committee, which is going to be working towards charitable status, to be actually working with local people to try and actually have a 200th anniversary in 4 years' time, which pays due respect to those who died and shows due remembrance. Because we should be remembering their suffering, we should be remembering their sacrifice, and we should be learning the lessons from 1826 in 2026 as well.
Well, we're at the beginning of a cost of living crisis, and in 4 years' time, on that 200 year anniversary, we might be looking at figures of people who have died over the next couple of years because they can't afford food or to put the central heating on. So
Have
we made progress in 200 years?
We know that there's been a decline in life expectancy, and we know that kind of life expectancy is likely to go down in the future. So we actually are still feeling the consequences of inequalities and issues around kind of food poverty. It's not exactly the same as what was happening in East Lancashire because we do have some kind of safeguards in place. Back in it, you know, today than what we had in 1826, but the connections are there. And if we're thinking about a serious issue, a serious concern being the generation of premature and avoidable deaths, whether that by intentional homicide or whether that by kind of starvation or whether by social murder and so on and so forth, when we start to recognise the seriousness of that, and we start to recognise that the state, as in 1826, is actually implicit in the generation of those deaths, then we start to recognise that the state is not necessarily our wonderful protector. Unless we actually make a stand and struggle and have our voices heard. And the one thing that happened with the Weavers in 1826, their voice was not heard, and therefore their suffering has been forgotten. The suffering of kind of the cost of living crisis today, if people's voices are not heard, people will not go out of their way in positions of power
to help them
or to listen to them. So it's for us to make sure that our voices are heard in the present. And I think it's also important, because of the kind of resonance and the connections, that the voices of those suffering weavers and other people who are working and living around East Lancashire nearly 200 years ago, I think it's crucial that their voices are heard, because they give us so much about what happens when the state fails to do its basic duty and meet its basic responsibilities to address the existential needs of those people that live in its community.
So how do you feel now, David, now you've finished the walk?
Well, pleased for the drink, but the walk was 9 miles, Janet, and of course, back in 1826, the weavers would have come down here, they'd have then spent time smashing up the power looms, and then they'd have had to walk back again.
Uphill as well,
uphill,
isn't it?
Well, obviously uphill, so it's kind of for another 9 miles, they've done 18 miles in total. I've been on a full belly, I've had drinks, I've got decent shoes and clothes, and it's a dry day. Could you imagine what it's like if you haven't had those things?
Yeah.
So I think it's worth remembering just how difficult it would have been for them back in 1826. Flossie, my dog, isn't here today. She kind of taught me the route, how to get down here, and she also kind of has done the other days, but it's a lot for a dog to do. 45 to 50 miles in 5 days. So
it's a lot for a person to do 45 miles in 5 days.
It is a bit. I've got one more day to go.
Yeah.
But just on the Flossie point, she's a rescue dog, and I was just saying to you before, Janet, that, you know, kind of, I'm not sure if I rescued her or she rescued me in terms of the kind of lifestyle changes and all the work, and I would never have discovered any of this if it hadn't been for Flossie kind of taking me on these different walks. So I really appreciate it to Flossie, and I appreciate to you guys for coming today as well and joining me on the walk, because it's wonderful to have you with us and to kind of to share this experience. And, you know, so thank you all very much.